National Assembly's committees, sorry, Communities, Equalities and Local Government Committee. We've had apologies this morning from Gwenda Thomas and again John Griffiths is substituting. Now the first item today is the seventh evidence session on the Renting Homes Wales Bill. Before I do that, can I just ask members if they have any declaration of interest first?
Yes.
Oh, Janet? Yes.
What's your interest?
What's your interest?
Oh, landlord.
Right, okay. Alan, did you?
Landlady.
Sorry?
I'm a private landlord.
Right, okay. Anybody else? Any other declarations of interest? Okay. Well, as I said, this is the seventh evidence session on the Renting Homes Wales Bill. And we have a panel with us this morning. Could I ask you to introduce yourself for the record, please? Karen, do you want to start?
Yeah, thank you. I'm Karen Anthony, Director of Policy for CLA Cymru.
Adrian Thompson, Guild of Residential Landlords and a private landlord.
Douglas Hagan, the Vice Chairman of the Residential Landlords Association and its Director for Wales, and I'm a private landlord as well.
Morning, Lee Cecil, National Landlords Association for Wales.
Okay, well, welcome to you all, and members will, I know you've sent some evidence in, members will have read the papers, so we'll go straight into questions. I just want to start off, I mean, there are, you know, it is quite a, well, it's a very technical bill, so there will be lots of specific questions, but I just want to start off. Could you sort of outline whether you feel the bill is necessary or not? And, you know, what are your views on this? So, who'd like to start?
I'll start then. I think, overall, initially we felt that, and we presented the evidence as such, that the bill could probably be achieved without quite so much complication, saying that, broadly, there are many measures within the bill that we do support, but we wanted to structure it under the current existing system. And maybe adjust some of the existing tenancies and areas like abandonment and bring those in because we're concerned about the overall cost and upheaval to the system overall.
Okay, would you all agree with that view generally?
I'd add to it really. It's as Doug says, and we're both law-abiding people around the table, and things are pretty common sense and straightforward, but what sort of baffles me over the last 10 years of doing this sort of role for the NLA is the predominance of the chair always being public sector. I would like, if we're going to go forward and really truly partner right across all the sectors with an inclusive home offer, then I think it would be nice to see a different group chaired by one of these people here, with the inclusion of all other sectors to actually deliver real housing options for the whole of Wales, because one three-bed terrace doesn't suit everyone. It's a different product and different locality, and whilst the regulation is fine, my problem has always been the regulation of good landlords and not dealing with the bad.
Do you think that, I mean, obviously the amount of legislation, do you think the amount of legislation impacting on the private rented sector, you know, how do you respond to that?
I think it is. But you've got, and again, you've got many different types of landlords. You've got the accidental landlord would only ever have one property, and normally that's by the death of a family member, or they've taken control of their own finances because they don't think their pension is going to be worth anything when they retire. So they're very unlikely to get a portfolio or even a second property. So I think that is little understood by people who just want regulation for regulation's sake.
Okay.
And again, it goes back to a group that actually delivers. Obviously, there has to be some priorities of what that group will do and what it would deliver in a short space of time, but that can easily be decided around the table such as this.
Okay. Well, I mean, obviously, we're going to look at some of the detail of the bill, and I just wondered, the members of the panel, they are proposing a one-day training course as part of the landlord licensing process. Do you think that's going to be sufficient for the landlord to become familiar with a bill of this size and complexity?
You know, CLA have long argued that a light-touch, non-regulatory approach would be less damaging for the sector. We're concerned, as we noted in our response, that there is sufficient legislative safeguards already in place, and the burden of over-regulation runs a very real risk of good landlords being driven from the sector. That, we feel, would have a distinct effect in the rural context on the impact of availability for affordable homes in those areas. With regards to having conversations with members of the public in the autumn of last year, when the mandatory landlord registration was going through the Senedd, there is a large degree of ignorance amongst the populace on the proposals. So we are deeply concerned. Lee refers to the accidental landlords, and we too would echo those sentiments. There are a number of people out there that, through no fault or no desire of their own, have found themselves in this position. This is undoubtedly a complex bill, as is outlined in the papers themselves, and this is yet a further tier of bureaucracy.
Okay. Adrian, any
response? I think that in answer to the question about one day, if I go back to that point, I think you can do it. I'm in quite a fortunate position. I actually do some of the training for the accreditation at the moment. I was there on Tuesday in North Wales, and we're already bringing this in at the moment just to forewarn the landlords who are attending right now. It's a long day and very hard to get everything in, but I think you probably can do it. I think if you started to try and increase that day to 2 days, for example, I think you really would alienate a lot of landlords. A day is bad enough when they arrive in the morning. Often they're not pleased to be there. Hopefully, I think they leave happy at the end. But I think if you made it longer than a day, it could really be a problem. Yeah.
I'm going to bring up, I know Jocelyn wants to go, but Alan first and then Jocelyn.
Yes, thank you. I was interested, Mrs. Anthony, in your closing remark. This is just another layer of bureaucracy. I'm a private landlord, and I don't see another layer of bureaucracy in this bill at all. In fact, as a private landlord, I would like to see it go a bit further to regulate the sort of accommodation that I see, both as a constituency member provided to people and also that I see in other places. I don't understand where the bureaucracy is in this. I was grateful if you could outline perhaps where it is.
I represent, as you are aware, rural businesses. The vast majority of those rural businesses are farming enterprises in Wales, and many instances, the larger estates have always had a residential portfolio associated with the holding. There are other situations, as my colleagues have alluded to, where people have invested in property as an alternative to a pension plan. Those individuals are already grappling with the legislation pertinent to their primary enterprise, whatever that may be, and the various forms of diversification that has been undertaken. The concern is deep-rooted in as much as I said, talking to people, for instance, in the dairy event in October of last year, we had been publicising the transit of the mandatory landlord registration through our monthly magazine, and it was amazing how many members hadn't taken fully on board, let alone people that were inquiring as to what services we actually offer as a membership organisation. So, any further legislation could be perceived as additional bureaucracy. We are finding ourselves in...
Any further legislation?
Of this nature in this area at the moment, yes. We've already got, as I said, the landlord registration coming in the autumn of this year. We've had the water undertakers regulations of recent times. And we are deeply concerned that those areas, again, there needs to be a more robust communications enterprise to ensure that not just members of our for associations, but the wider populace is aware of them. We don't want to inadvertently put people in positions of jeopardy for future sanctions against themselves.
No, we don't, but we're not children either.
No.
And, you know, as a landlord, I think I've got a personal responsibility to understand where the law is and how the law operates and how I fit into that. And as a businessman before I was elected, I took responsibility for ensuring that I run my business within the law. Now, surely the people you represent have the same responsibility.
They do indeed, and they don't shy away from that. But to be perfectly frank, what we're looking at, any further complexity to this kind of situation, the concerns of many of our members is that that will need to be reflected in rent increases. Certainly when you look at rural areas, you know, there are a number of situations where the rents aren't terribly high. There is a distinct urban-rural divide in the rental housing market.
Well, I'd like to see the numbers on that, Mrs. Anthony, because I suspect that things might be a bit different. Certainly my experience in Ceredigion is that rentals there can be considerably higher than they are in Blaenau Gwent. So I think you need to, I'd like to see the numbers, if you have, to sustain that argument.
But, okay. What you're saying is correct. No law-abiding person would have a problem with the law. The problem of any bill or law is a little bit like speeding. There's a 30 mile an hour limit, and some people will do that and some people won't. The problem with this is not the good landlords. It's never been the good landlords. It's been that law, well, you and I and Karen and ourselves would accept it. How do you manage the bad landlords that will never do it? Mm. So it goes back to enforcement, it goes back to regulation and implementing bills, and that has never been done.
Sure, I accept that. I don't disagree with your argument there at all. However, I don't think it's a very convincing argument to say we can't legislate on this because there's bad people out there who will ignore the law.
I'm not saying that.
I'm not suggesting that.
I don't think we are.
I accept that. But the point I'm making is that there must be a case and a very good case for saying we understand. And certainly, you know, my experience in the last 2 months canvassing, I've seen an awful lot of very poor accommodation in the private rented sector.
Far too much.
And I've seen that in too many places. And I come to this thinking we should be here looking at improving and increasing the quality and standards.
Agree.
Squeezing out, because if people are not prepared to abide by or to deliver on their legal responsibilities, I'm not sure I want to see them in the sector. I'm not sure I want to see them practicing.
Agreed.
You know, because people will suffer as a consequence of
Agreed.
That.
And so do we.
I would have thought that your organisations would have a very real desire to see greater regulation, greater enforcement, because that benefits everybody, both tenants and good landlords.
Right, I'm going to bring, Jocelyn wants to come, but I'm going to bring Douglas in first, and I know Peter, so Douglas, respond.
I agree with one of those two parts, is that we want to see greater enforcement. And the problem is that the enforcement is not being followed through as appropriately as it could be. And the automatic reaction constantly is that that when something's not happening to the level that we want it to happen to, and that's both sides of this table, that will automatically just create more regulation around it to improve it. And unfortunately what happens with that is that our members just turn around and comply, and the others don't comply. And so you get a greater gap between the poorer and the poor accommodation and the good accommodation. And equally, I'm not denying that when you went canvassing you saw some terrible properties, and I would love to go in there with you and tell you exactly how that could be enforced and brought up to the appropriate standard. But equally, I can take you to lots and lots of fantastic accommodation. For the, usually one of our members across this panel that are doing a very good job. And this is the distinction we have to make, is how do we actually solve the problems that we're facing? And I just don't think constant regulations, increased regulation is the right way. And we all need to sit together and figure out how to actually improve the enforcement standards.
I think this is part of you know, that process. But okay, I'm going to bring Jocelyn in, then Peter, then Mark.
Yeah, because I guess what you're saying is that some people will drive at 30 miles an hour and telling them to sit up straight
and not to talk to anybody, not on the radio, and doesn't stop the speeders, who doesn't care whatever the speed limit is, they'd be breaking it. So your problem is enforcement, even of current regulations on bad landlords, who say that this isn't going to solve that problem. I'm not sure about how you feel about the accidental landlords, because the number of you have mentioned it, saying, well, it's seen that was an alternative to a pension because I suppose interest rates are lower, whatever. And I agree entirely with Alan, whether you become accidental or whether you deliberately set out to have a good pension plan, you still have to do it properly and treat people decently. So I'm not sure how you feel about it. Because we did hear from Shelter during the last bill that a very significant proportion of their casework is landlords with one property. We were surprised to hear that it was such a problem. So it does seem that the accidental landlord or the person investing for their pension is a problem, and we need to address that. Can you tell us how you feel about the accidental landlord or the people with one property? Or, I mean, obviously, if you were you come here as represent umbrella organisations, bad landlords are unlikely to join you. You probably don't represent the bad landlords, and I don't suppose they'll be putting themselves forward to come and give evidence to us to defend their position.
Yeah, this is the part of the problem. And personally, and as an association, we have no problem with a landlord that has one property or a landlord that has 42,000 properties, which one of our members does have. Right? It's a staggering amount of property, but that's the case. They have to do it properly. Right? I continually say to individuals that do have one property, when we try and get them to join the NLA, they say, well, I've only got one landlord. And I say, well, it doesn't matter whether you've got one landlord or 1,000, the full weight of the law applies equally to you. So get your act together. Education, the speeding thing is, if you speed all the time, they get caught all the time, you're going to lose your licence. And this is very similar to what you're creating here. Everyone should have a chance to...
But you were not saying that. You were coming here and saying that what we are doing is over-regulating the driver that is not speeding, and the person that's speeding, we're not catching that person. That's what you were coming here to say.
Yes and no. There's a huge amount of regulation. Some of it we all agree with. Some of it I don't agree with, because what have we done over the last 10 years with the rogue and bad landlords in the UK, not just in Wales? Certain individual councils have done very excellent jobs, but it's not consistent, it's not right throughout the UK. So you can't, this is such a big bill, and there will be additions to it going forward. At the front end, when I started, this is about a working team, a task and finish group, whatever you want to call it, I don't really mind. But for me, it does have to have social income, social impacts at the end of it. So, if we're saying, right, we all agree we want to get the bad landlords out of it, and some of the accidental landlords are well-intentioned people, but they're not very professional, then we can educate those. But it always comes down in society that some people, you've just got to use a big stick. And if you take rented sector, unfortunately, is a huge attraction to organised crime, and then you're into a different league of enforcement, you're into a different league of management and what you do with them. But my issue has always been engagement, not enforcement. If you engage with the good, you'll get a far better result for the whole of the UK. If you enforce against the good and the bad, you get issues like this, where there's always a grey area.
Well, Jocelyn? We haven't had the powers in Wales for the last 10 years. This is one of the first opportunities we've had to do something about the private rented sector. And of course, that stick, if you like, it depends on the detail, and this is a very detailed piece of legislation. So how do you feel then about the effectiveness of this model contract? Getting down to the detail of it.
The model contract, I mean, obviously it's not laid down in primary legislation, which is
maybe a bit of a problem, because we could end up with a completely different model contract to what we've been presented with, and that's maybe a large problem with this bill overall.
Do you think it should be on the face of the bill?
Certain parts of it should probably be on the face of the bill. Okay. If we take the model contract in itself, yes, it's good to lay it down in certain circumstances, because we, when we're dealing with work, we come across so many different types of contracts, and some of them are handed down from various people, and they're not worth the piece of paper they're written on, half of them. So on that side of things, yes, that is positive. We would like to see the model contract. The fundamental terms are concerned about the way that's put together, in the sense of the arguments, and I think you made the representation as well on this, is of the fundamental terms, that it can only be changed in preference of the occupier. I think we'll get into all sorts of trouble with that.
I was going to ask you about that, actually, whether, you know, what you see the complications would be there.
It's going to be in the eye of the beholder as to whether that's...
Well, who would judge it? Who do you think should judge it?
I, in terms of the fundamental terms, I think we should just agree fundamental terms, and that's where we are with them. Because it's we just don't want to be ending up in court, which is where I think we'll end up a lot in those circumstances. You'll make minor mistakes on that, and
then you'll be in court.
Yeah, and there's no intentionality of doing anything rogue there for a lot of times.
Do you think that the contract holder, the tenant, then the contract holder will be able to negotiate with landlords about changing some of the terms?
Absolutely, and I think if we can continue to increase supply within the sector, which is really what we want to do, which enables improvement in the sector and competition within the sector, then people are going to be able to negotiate terms.
And landlords will be willing to do that, do you think?
I think it's demonstrated on a regular basis that landlords are highly negotiable on terms. I mean, there's going to be certain areas that are going to be incredibly popular. You know, we're in Cardiff, so one-bedroom flat in Cattays, for instance, would be face huge levels of demand. But there's plenty of scope for negotiation in other areas. And I suppose in some of the additional terms, I think we'd like to see a lot of them laid down. And discussed, so that people know that we can select from a number of additional terms, and we know that we're not going to be full foul of unfair contract terms.
Yes,
as well.
And then okay, but you think in terms of the ability to negotiate, it will depend on where the property is, how desirable it is, and how many tenants there are that want it, as to whether the landlord would be willing to negotiate, because he would have other people to turn to, other tenants to turn to.
Yes, to a certain extent.
It might not be in every case.
Supply and demand certainly does play a part.
Certainly in North Wales, the landlords that we have association with in North Wales, they have more property on occasion than they have tenants looking for property, so there is a definite geographical shift.
Yeah.
If I may add on the additional terms conversation, we have a number of people, because of the type of property that they're owning, thatched cottages, for instance, has come out as one particular situation, yeah, where because of insurance clauses, there are requirements on certain safeguards within the home that we'd need to see some flexibility within additional terms to satisfy those situations, rather than see these buildings unoccupied.
So I guess what you're saying is that you have to take into consideration that the private rental sector market has got a huge variety, not just of people, but a huge variety of properties, the sorts of properties.
It does
indeed. Some of them are going to be quite old.
Some of them quite old, some of them, frankly, quite unique.
Yes.
And although...
Listed? You know,
most definitely listed. Listed and historic properties. So each has a charm, some also has its challenges. And we can't shy away from any of those.
Yeah, okay. I noticed that you... How do you all feel then about the being able to, you know, give this contract electronically rather than... Because I know you've had concerns about the amount of paper.
That could prove a challenge for some of the rural areas. Again, you know, I have to say that until we've got adequate broadband coverage, we're getting there, but it's not quite there yet. We've experienced difficulties, I can speak on the part of the farming community in recent weeks, in getting their basic payment scheme forms completed. So there are challenges. There would certainly be a desire that if it could be done electronically, it could be useful, but we're not in a position to be able to say that it's a wholly electronic situation.
And it could be in the future that could be better.
In the future,
I guess you
who knows?
I think we should reverse the stance. And this, I think we should actually be saying it should be digital by default with, and you can't refuse.
But hard
the
copy on request.
Absolutely, yeah. You can't refuse that request for a hard copy because, I appreciate your situation and those that are not particularly digitally connected. I mean, some of the facts of digital connectivity in Caerphilly are quite surprising. Yeah. So we don't want to exclude those, but really the vast majority of the private rented sector would prefer and be more likely to engage with digital copies.
But with an exception if there is no broadband available to the...
Or if it's requested by the tenant.
You mentioned in your evidence the Rent Act 77. You think that they should be included in the scope of the bill, but you'd like to exclude service occupiers. Could you expand a little bit on that and your reasons for that?
Well, the service occupiers could present a challenge, frankly, with regards to contracts of employment. Quite often, less so these days, but we still see contracts of employment that come with accommodation. And when there has been a change, a breakdown in a relationship on the employment contract or a retirement, etc., then you know the property is still needed for
the
next person. So that could be a difficult situation to manage. With regards to the Rent Act situation, quite often the Rent Act, what we would like to see in the Rent Act, frankly, is that any improvements that are undertaken, then you could accept a cumulative review to look at the rent. So what we're finding is that because of the way the legislation is at the moment, if you undertake one improvement, it stands in time. The next improvement stands in time. We don't have regard for the cumulative effect, which we think would benefit, frankly, both landlord and tenant in many situations in being able to bring forward more improvements to the quality and the standard of the housing in the long term.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right, now before we want to move on shortly to an issue about joint contracts, I'm going to bring John in, but before that I know a number of members had some specific questions. Can we make them quite brief because obviously we've got quite a lot of things to cover. So I've got Peter, Mark, Janet, Alan and Mike. So Peter first.
I think we've moved on since my question,
okay.
So I'm not going to go back where we were.
Okay, Mark?
You mentioned the need to target criminal or bad landlords rather than add to the greater burden for all landlords. What action do you think should be taken alternatively to meet that goal? Bearing in mind a contract is a two-party matter involving both landlords' rights and responsibilities and tenants' rights and responsibilities. So protecting the most vulnerable tenants and enabling them to exercise their rights if faced with a criminal or bad landlord, but equally enforcing the responsibilities of the tenant to the contracts that they've entered into with the landlord. And related to that, in the context of the limitations expressed by local authorities on their ability to resource further enforcement, how do we address the need to tackle those bad landlords once councils are made aware of their existence?
And I think I've had a lot of conversations with different police forces, Home Office, to try and get an answer to that. A, to make them aware that landlord associations are willing to partner and work in partnership with them if needed. A couple of years ago, I worked with Neath Council, the illegal money laundering outfit, Neath Landlord Forum, etc. All the local major stakeholders to put away a rogue landlord who'd been operating for over 25 years. The interesting observation for me is in that relationship with those local stakeholders, individually, they all knew this gentleman. And I was a bit shocked, quite frankly, because I said, well, you've got the power to put him away, so why aren't you putting him away? And there were certain excuses at the time, and the solution of that was partnership, so we partnered together. So for me personally, I knew that worked. So that could be scaled up. Now, everything costs, and there's a lot of reduction in a lot of public sector budgets, so I'm conscious of that. But when you, listening to my police colleagues, how it works, you get proceeds from organised crime, that then can go back into community benefit schemes. So I said, well, okay then, if it's that big a problem, it's got to be a big enough problem. If it's one person, then you can alert, there's channels to go through that should quickly and easily solve that. But that's not the case either, because I know another individual instance in Cardiff where it didn't, sadly. But to work together, organised in a way, proceeds a crime, then pay for it. Sometimes it's a 3-year, 5-year regeneration thing, because on the back of drugs, prostitution, etc., etc., the usual stuff, there's a lot of hurt in that community, which you could engage with third sector and voluntary sector organisations equally to then come together, because dealing with organised crime is not a quick fix.
Okay, Dougie, did you have a comment?
It's not a unique problem to Wales, and as a result of this, the RLA put together a manifesto which we sent to, I think we've sent to the vast majority of the members here, if not all of that, and that does contain a lot of ideas in terms of co-working for enforcement, because we understand we can't just turn around and say, well, you've got to put more money into this to enforce it, because there's not a lot of money there. Our main policy really is around the concept of co-regulation, which is working on a similar model to that of building regs, where you can draft in partners to help regulate those in the sector that are signed up good and accredited landlords, and they are governed by a co-regulatory partner, so that you can focus your enforcement on those that aren't under co-regulation or those that aren't dealt with effectively by co-regulatory partners. So we'd really encourage you to look at that model if you've got the time afterwards, and I'm happy to go through it in more detail with any of the members.
Okay, thank you. Alan, did you want to ask a question?
Yeah. I sympathise greatly, Mr. Hager, Mr. Sasser, with your response on enforcement, and I was simply going to ask if you could provide the committee with a note on enforcement issues, because it isn't contained in the legislation. You're absolutely right, and I thought that would be useful for us in our deliberations.
Okay, we could do that. That'd be good. No. Mike.
Yeah, very briefly to Ms. Anthony. I go back when IT, before broadband existed, and everything was sent under baseband. We still sent documents around under baseband. It'll be slower, but I don't understand why you can't send it. Even when people haven't got broadband, they can pick it up under baseband. It might take 10 times as long, but why can't it be sent?
It can certainly be sent. Our concerns, frankly, is in the receipt of it. So we're still experiencing some instances of the signal being disturbed and a big document failing to come through properly.
Along sort of what I'll describe the BT copper type of electrical line is being disturbed.
Yeah, there are still periodic reports of difficulties. We are in discussions with BT themselves and in certain geographical areas. But, you know, as Douglas said, we're more than happy for it to be electronic, but we have to have a reserve standpoint of a paper copy at this point in time.
Very happy with that. And I suggest you take things up with BT, because that should
not
be happening.
We will indeed be doing so.
Okay, we're going to move on now to some of the specifics. But John, you've got a question on joint contracts.
Yeah, some questions on joint contracts and the provisions that are suggested to provide more flexibility, really, for standard contracts, and particularly the periodic standard contracts. And your views, really, on how that might impact that greater flexibility in terms of individuals withdrawing from tenancies, the effect then on remaining contract holders and potential problems for landlords. If you could just set out your general views on the provisions and how you think they would impact, I think that would be useful for the committee.
Okay. Adrian?
I think our main concern is, the first thing I would say is, at the moment, of course, the tenancy ends. If we just take the removal of one for a moment, then if one gives notice to quit, say there's four,
and one of those gives a notice to quit, then the whole tenancy ends. So that's what you're trying to fix. I don't personally have any issue whether it ends the tenancy or not, really. Your proposal is that it wouldn't end the tenancy, and that's fine. What my worry is the scenario, and it is in the response, is say we have four tenants on a property and two or three go or give notice to leave. That then leaves that poor single tenant with one heck of a burden of a four-bedroom house with really they're completely stuck and bound. And the problem is when it comes to then if perhaps they went to the local authority for housing, they could say, well, you know, I have a problem. They wouldn't be homeless because they have a tenancy in place. And, of course, they can't give a notice to quit because then they're intentionally homeless. Now, it has been put to me that local authorities will see sense and that they will take that into consideration. But, frankly, if there aren't any houses, I'm afraid that they use everything in their powers. Guidance at this very minute says where a Section 21, the 2 months no-fault notice has been served. Actually, when that's expired, they should treat them as homeless from that point of expiration. But everybody, every local authority that I know of awaits a court order. Some even wait for the bailiff, which is frankly disgusting. And so I fear that although it may be good intentioned that where this single person is stuck with this tenancy that they don't particularly want anymore and can't give notice, I fear that that is a problem. As it's fairly straightforward, I would have thought, you could legislate the homeless provision of the local authority in that kind of scenario. Maybe you could say if there is more than 50% of the of tenants remaining, I don't know. But you could force the local authority to deem them as homeless in some kind of position like that, I would have thought, and then it would be okay. But that's my worry. Not as a landlord, I don't think we really care either way. It's the tenant is of concern to us.
Douglas, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I agree with the vast majority of what Adrian said, and he's outlined the case very well. There are scenarios when actually you've got maybe two or three people in the property, that tenancy was set up predominantly on the basis of the income and security provided by two, and you could be left with a third, which is possibly less secure income. And as a landlord, it's your responsibility to make sure that, as partly as well, to make sure that that person is capable of maintaining that tenancy. And that's what we're encouraged to do, is be responsible landlords for our tenants. So our proposal would be to balance the bill, not to change the overall idea, because I don't think it's a bad idea for people to be able to exit contracts without ending the tenancy, but for everybody to be given, at the point of one person giving notice, for everybody to be given the opportunity, including the landlord, to terminate that tenancy at the same time, if they chose to do so. If one person gave notice and everybody else was happy to continue, that's absolutely fine. If one person gave notice and one of the other parties also wanted to leave, then they should have the opportunity to leave or terminate the tenancy at the same time. So it just balances it both ways to make sure that it's you know, everybody can afford it.
Just one other point, really, on deposits, because obviously if one contract holder does withdraw, where there are more than one, and withdraws their deposit, there's a question then, isn't there, in terms of the remaining contract holders, and indeed the landlord's confidence that the total amount of deposit is enough to cover eventualities. Have you got a view on how that situation could be dealt with by this legislation?
It's incredibly concerning, this section, but and probably could take most of the session to really debate it all, but it is something that needs to be looked at. We don't have a direct solution, because ultimately if you're doing things properly, when a tenant leaves, you need to do a full inventory and schedule a condition of that property, and finalise any deductions on that basis. Doing that with tenants in situ is very difficult to do. It's difficult enough as it is to get it right when the property is empty. And if you want to put another tenant back in, that makes the situation even more complex. And if you're using the custodial scheme, which locks the money away, you've got another layer of complication on top. So there's quite a lot of work around this area that needs to be done before I'd be happy personally on this scenario. Intention's great, and we'd support the intention, but we need to iron these things out because this legislation, the deposit legislation, has added so it's something like £2.50 a week to tenancy costs as a result of the complexity of it. So this may increase that cost further.
Yeah. What a good example would be if you've got there's an iron being put on the floor in the living room. It never ceases to amaze me how many times I see an iron mark on the carpet. It's always bizarre. So the outgoing tenant, so we go and check it, but the remaining three have put the sofa over the iron mark to cover it up. So we go in and check it. Does the new tenant coming in, when the property is now empty, are they now liable for the iron mark that was before they entered? Because, of course, nobody saw it because the tenants had covered it up with the sofa, and we're not going to, surely we can't go around stripping the property to inspect. So it's how you fix that, I don't know, I'm afraid, but that would be a genuine concern and problem that would be real.
Again, it's something we'd love to work with you on and the deposit schemes to try and work this out.
Okay. Mark, is this on joint contracts? Yeah, okay, and then I want to move on to Gwyn then on deposits. So, Mark?
When a household breaks up, a mortgage lender cannot release the exiting parties from the mortgage unless the remaining parties show that they can afford to fund the mortgage alone or with a guarantor. Should that not apply in circumstances such as this?
I think that was mostly my point around the security and assuring that the remaining tenants can afford it. So yes, I would agree entirely with that.
Okay, Jocelyn.
Can you just on this point here, I mean, the mortgage is slightly different because you borrowed the money in the beginning.
That's not the same as paying the rent next week, is it? This is a future liability. You've both borrowed the money, so you have to both pay back the money. Is there any liability between the tenants, or if I'm in a joint tenancy with Rodri, by the way, we're not in a joint tenancy, with you, Douglas, one of us leaves, so the remainder has to carry on paying the rent. Why can't I just sue Rodri on the side here for his proportion of the rent that he said that he'd pay in the beginning? What's that got to do with you?
So Rodri's left or I've left? So
you're the landlord. Living with you. Okay. I'm living with Rodri. You're the landlord. We're not living together, but we should. He leaves, I'm left having to pay the rent to you.
Yeah.
So joint tenancies finished, I'm paying the rent to you. Why can't I just sue Rodri by you're in the county court for his proportion of the rent he said he paid?
Well, under the existing laws, that's what happens. Yes.
So why doesn't that, because that's a separate thing altogether, isn't it? That is just common law. I can sue Rodri for the contract that he's broken with me. You don't have to sue Rodri.
No, that's absolutely, and likely you would be the first point of contact normally. Under those circumstances, we would indeed contact Rodri as well, but it's easier to contact the person that's still remaining.
I still have to pay all the rent, but I can sue Rodri for his portion.
Yeah, and that's how it is.
But that doesn't happen. That wouldn't probably happen with the mortgage, would it? Because the mortgage company keeps going after both of you.
Yes.
Doesn't all the liabilities cease once the correct procedures follow? Doesn't the outgoing tenant
and the new procedure, yes.
cease? So you wouldn't be able to sue because there is no more liability.
Well, you wouldn't be able to sue, but I might be able to sue.
I don't think so because there'd be no liability.
Yeah, under the new procedure, under the current situation, that's exactly what would happen. Under the new procedure for being able to terminate a single contract, that they are able to do that. As long as they've given the right notice and the correct procedure is taken, that person can leave and they are no longer jointly liable.
To you, but are they jointly liable?
No, they wouldn't be jointly liable to you either, no. That's what's my point.
So it takes the right of the existing tenant to be able to go after Rodri for his half of the rent.
That was my point. You're now stuck with a tenancy you may not necessarily want. Yeah.
So it means I can't get sued by anybody?
Absolutely.
You're all sorted.
You've done well.
Right, we're going to move on now. Gwyn, you had a question.
My question is not complicated for you, but good morning to you all. Could I ask you how effective deposit protection is at present and whether the bill improves on the current arrangements?
would like just to answer that one.
I don't see much change. I think it's horrific. The problem with the deposit legislation is that everybody's a criminal all of a sudden because nobody can get it right because it's so complicated. If you are not giving around 12 pages of prescribed information which nobody understands, then you owe between 1 and 3 times penalty and you can't serve a Section 21 and that's it. And the problem is everybody feels such a criminal for getting it wrong in the first place because they didn't intend to, they didn't mean to. Many are protecting them perfectly well. And I'm not sure I see any change, really. It seems to me it's exactly the same wording as what we already have. So I don't mind the principle in theory, but it's that nobody can get it right. It's so complicated. And mainly the information, if it could just be a sheet, it would help. It's the vast amount. It's so difficult.
I would agree with Adrian. I think the deposit legislation is an abhorrent piece of legislation and it's probably what should be being examined right now instead of this bill. But it's incredibly difficult to fully comply with and has caused probably more complications since it's been introduced than before. But the balance of this bill, I don't think there's any significant balance other than the joint contract holders situation, which definitely needs to be resolved before we allow that to happen.
Okay. Gwyn,
just going on to rent increases, really. Could you have your views on the suggestion that there should be some rent controls in the private rented sector? That'll make you smile.
Well, I mean, if you go back to the 1977 Rent Acts,
we have a number of those still. Well, I think they're nearly all gone, but the simple fact is you cannot physically afford to do those ones up because you can't increase the rent. You know, you couldn't go around and put central heating in, for example. All rent control does is give you bad properties. That's all rent control does and makes people exit the market. I'm a real believer of if you want to control rents, dump 1 million properties on the market and you'll control your rents.
Any other views?
Well,
I think the other view is reality. A lot of valley towns in the usual areas, we all know around this table, there are areas of deprivation and still are, sadly, that you don't need rent control because open market rent is local housing allowance, which is housing benefit.
Sometimes though.
Even lower. So you've got that anyway. What I'd rather do is look at ways of energising those areas in a joint approach. Not as was suggested on a TV programme recently, you know, getting everyone out to North Rhondda and moving them somewhere else, because that doesn't work. So again, it's your understanding of what rent control is. London is a different market. We don't have Cardiff, to a certain degree, is not London obviously, but it's vibrant, it's got job creation. Job creation provides a lot of positive things, but for people that can't afford because of their lack of income, and then you're talking about economics and other things. So I think in a lot of places you've already got rent control.
Okay. We've finished, Greg?
Yeah, thank you very much.
Alan, you had a supplementary.
Yeah, a fair rent, of course, is fair to a landlord and fair to a tenant. And that generally happens when the market is in equilibrium, when there's a relatively similar number of people seeking to a number of properties available. Where it's out of equilibrium, either rents fall or rents go through the roof. Surely a level of regulation would provide a structure within the market which would enable the market to function effectively, because we've seen the property market go completely out of control in all sorts of different ways in the United Kingdom over the last few decades, and I'm not sure that's provided us with the sort of market for homes, if you like, that we any of us would necessarily choose.
Well, if you look at Wales, then we've actually had a reduction in rents compared to inflation over the last 2 or 3 years, and overall we're well below inflation in the last 10 years. So from the perspective of the tenant, they're actually in a fairly good situation. If you're looking at controlling rents, then for that to be fair, if we're going to use that word, then really you need to restrict house prices. Because even if you look at And I'm not suggesting we do that, by the way, but if you look at the actual profitability of your standard private rented sector property, if you put down a 30% deposit, you, even in areas of traditionally high rent, for instance, Cardiff again, then you're not making obscene profits by any means. And all you need is a couple of months of rent not being paid by a tenant or having to refurbish the kitchen, and you've taken your profits away for the next 2 to 3 years. Property investors, and I think everybody on this panel would agree that property is not a short-term market to be in. We always invest on the long, in the long-term basis. I would never advise anybody to put their money into property on making a short-term gain. So realistically, it's very rarely you're investing your money purely on the basis of your rental income. So any restriction of that is going to disrupt the market in a negative way, reduce standards and reduce supply.
I'd like to see your numbers on that.
I was actually going to bring them in for the panel today, but
wider economic analysis, of course, is that property is...
We've got an entire paper written by Professor Ball, which we can present to you, who was the Labour advisor, economic advisor back in early 2000. So, and he wrote a paper on this, and we can present you that.
Okay. Sure, because the information that you would generally see, economic commentary, of course, is that given where we are with mortgage rates, given where we are with interest rates at the moment, the property is the only serious one, except what you say about longer term, is the only way of maintaining serious growth in terms of profitability. And I've got no issue with that. I've got no issue at all with people receiving a significant return for making a significant investment. I've got no issue with that at all. My concern is that it's done fairly and within a regulated market, which enables both tenants and landlords to have a fair deal.
But you've already pointed out that in the cases that you get a fair rent on the basis of supply, and whether that goes up and down. So would it not be better to be looking at how do we increase supply so that everybody can live in the areas and the types of properties that they want to live in, which means that if you increase supply, you also generally increase quality. And so therefore we should be looking at planning laws and building regulations and areas like that and brownfield sites in city centres, as opposed to just saying, well, no, we're just going to be, we'll choose the easy option and we'll just cap rents and that'll be
it. I don't disagree with you, but you do accept then that there is a role for public intervention in the marketplace.
No, I think there's a role for public intervention in terms of getting the ability to build properties where we need them built at the speed we need them built. That's why
it's set. Public intervention, we just want it in different places.
Well, but ours is about encouraging investment and growth and the capacity for people to live where they want to live. I think that rent control is just going to drive everybody out of the market and mean that you're going to have poorer quality properties and less choice for people in the market.
Because that's not everybody's experience. It's not the international experience either.
But the basis of rent control in other cities and other countries is done with a much wider look at the economic situation.
I'd be happy with that.
And you can't just introduce one part of the law. You've got, if you want to introduce rent control, like as in areas of Germany, you've got to bring in all of the economic benefits and advantages of owning the properties
that
you have in Germany as well. So it's not just a simple tick in the box saying we've got rent control.
Okay,
so, and we can provide information on that as well.
I'm going to move on, because I know some members haven't come in yet. So Peter.
On the point of supply, I accept there's a supply issue at the moment, but demand also, of course, impacts on rents as well, particularly where there is low demand. But that's not the situation at the moment, obviously. Moving on to the six-month moratorium, I'm just interested in your views on the current proposal in the bill, which effectively abolishes that six-month moratorium.
It's a good thing. You know, if somebody just wants a two-month tenancy for some genuine reason, occupation contract, my apologies, then I see no reason why we shouldn't be free to do that. And if for some reason a court order is required, why our agreement between two parties should be interfered with for no gain.
Is it going to lead to an increase in costs for both landlords and tenants as properties change hands more frequently?
The reality is that will not happen. I don't think that many people really realise about the six-month Tory MP anyway, we're in the business of letting property, not evicting people. That's our job. Evictions cost money, they lose rent. But the free market, that ability to know that if there is a problem, it can be resolved, is what fuels the market and brings landlords in, because of that ability to be able to serve notice.
I mean, in reality, if you want to serve notice at the beginning of the tenancy, it's going to take you 2 or 3 months to get them out anyway, isn't it?
Absolutely. And and you're proposing the use it or lose it anyway, so that you know it runs out, as it were, which is a change from now. I just don't see that. I've never understood the need for it from day one when they introduced it. I've never understood why.
I mean, we've had evidence from tenants who consider that it actually reduces their level of security, because they feel that, you know, at the moment they've got 6 months, they feel they could be kicked out at any moment.
But if they're given a 6-month tenancy, they can't be given, they can't be evicted sooner.
No, but if you get rid of the 6-month moratorium, you can.
Yeah, but I think that as a rule, generally, landlords give either a 6 or a 12 month tenancy in the real world. There are exceptionally few that will give less, and that's where your negotiations come in. If for some reason somebody wants a lower one, maybe the moving house, sale fell through, something along those lines, or flood, fire, so they're wanting temporary accommodation. I think that what you would actually find is at the moment that landlords would be fearful, potentially, of giving a shorter one, because there's no point if you've got the 6 month, whereas now you would free that up for those that want it. But I don't think you are going to see, if you remove it, I think I can say with relative certainty, everybody all of a sudden granting 1 month tenancies all of a sudden. I just don't think that's realistic. Why would we want to have to re-let the property every 2 months? That's hugely expensive to re-let a property every time.
Which is my point, I think,
yeah.
In terms of...
Yeah, yeah. So, I don't see the need for it.
And I think Douglas, in his evidence, has indicated that there's a case for a longer-term tenancy, which would both provide security both for tenants and for landlords. I mean, how would that fit in with the proposals under this bill?
I think we've certainly recognised in our conversations, both in Westminster and for the Assembly, that there is a requirement for landlords to be able to provide and feel comfortable in providing long-term tenancies, because ultimately landlords do want to rent for a long period of time. We don't want to evict. If someone turned around to me and said, I want to take this property for 20 years and we agreed rent increase negotiations over time, I'd be quite happy to consider it for the vast majority of my properties. So, but there's no real mechanism in place to easily do that. So we would be keen to establish a comfortable long-term tenancy contract that both landlords were comfortable with and tenants were comfortable with. And I would see that the abolishment of the six-month moratorium working very well in those scenarios, saying that you go for a probationary period at the initial stint of that long-term contract to ensure that both sides are happy, because ultimately a tenant can look at a property and say, well, it looks very nice, but you move into it and 2 months later you've got damp and things like that because it's just been painted over. But likewise, I can have somebody turn up in a suit and it turns out that they love late night parties and causing hell to all the neighbours. So equally, that gives us that flexibility to at the beginning of the contract, and I think that's one of the positive areas, if we can tie it in with not a compulsory long-term tenancy agreement, because the vast majority of tenants don't want long-term tenancy agreements. And in our experience in renting the properties, actually, we've been trying to get year-long contracts, and most of them want 6 months. So the driver is that actually most tenants want the flexibility of a short-term contract. But I understand for families that move into a catchment area of a school or other examples similar to that, they want that stability, and we'd be keen to work on
how would we work that into this bill? I mean, we have a situation now where all we're proposing is to get rid of the 6 month moratorium. Could you have an alternative where you have a longer tenancy with a probationary period instead of that, or would you say make that an option in addition to that?
I think it would be an option in addition to it. I don't know. We've been trying to finish it, a model contract to propose the terms. We only finished it at the beginning of this week. We did send it out. I realise it's very short term for you to look at it at the proposed tenancy. But yes, it would be a separate proposal, but it with a probationary period and then an effective right to renew, as opposed to a necessarily up to 5 years, as opposed to a set 5 year period with break clauses for either side to allow you to do that.
And you keep the abolition of the 6 month moratorium alongside that?
Yes, that would be our proposal. Okay. Because to allow for the areas that Adrian's talking about. So
from the rural point of view, the 6 month moratorium,
most tenancies have an initial 6 term in any instance. It's no real good reason why the moratorium will cause any difficulty. People need flexibility, but equally the experience of some of the rural properties, people have been in them for significantly longer than 12 months. We're talking a number of years in many instances.
Okay.
Right, you know, we've got a quarter of an hour left. It's not a huge amount of time. I know other members want to come in with specific issues, so I am going to go on the order that we have discussed previously. Alan, do you have a question?
Yeah, one of the issues which we've debated and discussed here has been the government's proposal to extend ability of 16 and 17-year-olds to have rental contracts. Do you have any views on this issue?
Go for it. Simple.
Do you all agree with that?
Yeah,
Karen?
No problem as far as we're concerned. The only thing that I would say is, from my experience from a former life, certainly when I worked with benefits delivery, then there were situations where young people could not enter into contracts for the provision of utilities, etc. That was certainly a flashpoint for care leavers. That is going back a few years, and it may have changed, but I don't suppose it's changed terribly much. So that would certainly be an area that I would be concerned of for the individual as opposed to any other party.
I'm with Karen on that. I'm not understanding every part of legislation, so I'm not sure how far that goes. Whilst I don't have any particular objections in principle, I am concerned that landlords could get caught out because of other areas. There's also if you did unfortunately have to evict somebody, then you're in a situation where you have to have somebody accompany them to court. I think if they're 16 or 17, they can't attend on their own, which obviously increases costs and the problems around that. And then I suppose that in reflection, most people that are 16 or 17 are either doing it under the care of their parents, if they've gone to university early, for instance. I know, especially in Scotland, the education timescale is slightly different, so you often get 17-year-olds coming down and renting there, or they're doing it under the basis that they're not able to live with their family anymore, in which case, in those circumstances, they either are under the guise of the local authority or should be under the guise of the local authority. So I think in those two circumstances, I'd rather see either local authority take those contracts or parents take those contracts with the permission to sublet, just to remove any of these other areas of complication. But as I say, in principle, I don't have an issue. I'm just concerned what are the consequences there.
Lee, did you have
I think the practicality would be working together. No one's mentioned social landlords. So, you know, private landlords don't have a problem working with social landlords in a given specialist niche market, which this would be, because despite the age, a landlord would look at affordability of can you pay the rent. So, and a 16 or 17-year-old, are they a 16 and 17-year-old chaotic 16 or 17-year-old? And that could apply to any age. So why do they need a property, blah, blah, blah. So you should obviously interview correctly prospective tenants, but if there was a continual demand for that type of accommodation in a particular area, then perhaps a partnership between private sector and social landlords might benefit that locality.
Okay. Alan, okay?
Yes, okay.
Roger.
Thank you very much, Chair. I have two rather technical questions in relation to possession, and I think that we could write to the witnesses with both of those technical questions to save time, because time is against us. So can I just ask the general question that I have about the provisions in relation to antisocial behaviour? What is your opinion of those provisions, and what effect do you think that this will have on private landlords?
Again, for me, you know, I've come across several quite nasty situations over the 10 years. The landlord in this particular case that I'll quote was not the issue. It was the tenants in the property. It was they were on benefits, so the council were paying the benefits. How the hell I got involved, I don't know, but I got involved, and I rang the council and I said, well, can you do something? Can we partner together, blah, blah, blah. There were stabbings, there was all sorts of stuff involved, sadly, over a long period of time. And it's still there. So antisocial behaviour as a you must not do it is all well and good. We can all say that as long as we're here. But what happens when something happens? So landlords do not have the power of a council. Council have far more power than the police, as I found out over the decade I've been dealing with these situations. So by all means, say, don't drop litter, you know, be a good citizen, blah, blah, blah. But what happens when it happens next to you? And the lady living next to this particular property, a homeowner, well, she's got stress and blah, 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 blah. She's very ill now, and she had nowhere to go. So all well and good, but what happens after?
I think antisocial behaviour is by far the most difficult individual scenario for a landlord to deal with. It can be incredibly distressing, obviously, for neighbours and residents in the local area, and can be incredibly distressing for a landlord as well. And often it's one of those things that gives our industry a bad name, because the tenants that go into the properties create antisocial behaviour, and actually the powers that the landlord has to deal with it are very, very limited. And getting a court order, for possession order for antisocial behaviour is nigh on impossible. But the problem is that the landlord is the one that tends to get blamed for putting these tenants in their properties. So we would love to see provisions strengthened. I know that the provisions were strengthened in the recent Police and Crime Act, but they didn't really particularly strengthen the position that landlords were in. Social landlords are able to get exclusions and injunctions. I'm not saying that private landlords should individually be given that power, but certainly I think that local authority and police should be bound to, when requested by a landlord, to intervene on areas of antisocial behaviour, to help a landlord deal with that area, to be able to maybe get injunctions and similar powers that exist for social landlords. That's the sort of thing that we'd like to see, because at the moment we're still very little we can do.
Karen?
I agree with Linda, a few of Alan's words earlier, that there are individual responsibilities. The landlord can only do so much, but the responsibility lies with the tenant, antisocial or other.
Like what I would add, because discharge of duty of homelessness to the private rented sector and now is going through and whatever. So there needs to be an education for those tenants that are being placed into the private rented sector, because, for example, they're not used to paying for a lot of things historically, and when they're asked to pay, they're very worried and concerned, and obviously, quite rightly, they stick their feet and say, well, I've never paid before, so they don't know. It's not the fact that they don't want to, they just don't understand. So I think education needs to be done on that part as well.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
Well, so the provisions in this bill is not going to make any difference whatsoever.
There are changes which strengthen it, but yeah, it doesn't define it.
Okay. Roger? Okay. Mike?
Put them together. is retaliatory eviction a serious problem in the private rented sector? And would you all prefer the approach taken in the Deregulation Act 2015 to be adopted?
Well, I'll answer the retaliatory question from my own point of view. I don't think it is, but you just got to look at the people that are suggesting to you that it is. It means usual organisations for a long time have said 70% of my staff's time is taken with bad landlords. And have constantly said, well, let's work together and we can get that down. And they don't want to.
Has got cases of retaliatory eviction in their casework. Every single one of us. If you've ever contacted a local
case studies and do something together then, and then you won't have a problem. I've said that for 10 years.
Certainly we've, you know, because nobody comes to us unless they've got a problem. Yeah. They don't come to us and say everything's fab.
And the threat to retaliatory eviction as well. People are told if you complain, we will evict you.
Well, let's work together. Take real case studies, which you've got, and then report back in an open and honest way, and then do something about it.
We believe that there is current provisions there to actually prevent retaliatory eviction. I don't deny that they are complex, but I believe that our policy director is very keen to get hold of a case to try and test them if somebody wanted to present a case. But we don't deny that they exist, but I do think that the amount of it is overplayed. I mean, you just have to look at the total number of evictions that are generated by landlords is less than 7%, and that's of all evictions in terms of rent arrears, antisocial behaviour, ending of tenancies for selling the house, all sorts of things. So retaliatory eviction is going to be a tiny fraction of that. However, yes, it does exist, so if we're not going to accept that there are defences in place already, no, we don't want what's written in the deregulation bill. That's incredibly complex. But what we would like to see is the introduction of... our concern is the way that it's currently written is it's very, very broad.
Yeah.
Very, very broad. And we could have all sorts of fun and games coming up as a result of delayed evictions. And that's just going to destabilise the market. It's going to increase people like shelters' time spent on spurious places. It's going to increase our time. It's going to just discourage landlords from renting to higher risk tenants, which is absolutely not what you want to happen, considering you've just passed the Housing Wales Act. So really what we need to do is bring a lot of guidance around that. One of those things we'd like to see is actually that a complaints procedure is put in place on how a repairs reporting procedure is put in place, which tenants need to follow, so that if it does get to the point where it's retaliatory eviction is claimed, then there's evidence to be able to back that up because they followed the procedure. And I think that's just part of what is an overall education programme to tenants, which we need to encourage, because we need to encourage them to make better decisions as to where they live. But I think that it cannot delay. The most important thing is whatever we put in place cannot delay the possession proceedings as they are, because they're far too long as it stands, and it cannot discourage landlords from renting to high-risk tenants on the basis that there's going to be lots of spurious claims, which is just going to absorb lots of our costs and time.
Okay. Mike, any other?
Yeah, no, let's be finished.
Okay. Janet, you had a question?
Good morning. What impact do you think the proposals in the bill relating to the disrepair and fitness, because there's been much talk during our evidence session about fit for human habitation. Of course, in Scotland, they've gone a lot further. Oh, goodness me, I would think it's a nightmare trying to actually include things such as white goods and general fixtures and fittings. What is your view on that? Do you think what is meant by fit for human habitation should be on the face of the bill rather than left to regulations?
Yeah, I mean, I'm extremely frightened about it being connected to the housing health and safety rating system. If you put 10 environmental health officers in a room and ask, is this category 1 or category 2? The classic is the dark cellar, no light bulb, with concrete steps and a concrete floor and no handrail. Most environmental health officers will say that's immediate death, category 1, which of course isn't right, because how often do you go into an empty cellar? 4 times a year. So you're reducing the likelihood, and so the calculation works out, actually, it's not
as severe. Mm-hmm. So the problem with the HHSRS is there's 29 hazards, including, for example, lead. So is all of a sudden a lead water mains pipe all of a sudden now under the fitness standard? Personally, I think it would be far better just to say what it is you want. What do you want? And say so, rather than the HHSRS is okay for what it does and gives local authorities immense powers for repairs and works needed. That's no problem with that. It's a fitness standard, understanding the formula. I don't know if anybody's ever seen the formula in the regulations, but I do half day to a day training just on the calculation alone of how you work out whether it's category one or two. To try and get a landlord to understand whether what they have is a one or a two would just be immensely difficult, if not impossible. And again, we're back to this thing, would you just create criminals without realising, you know, people didn't realise. But I think if you just say what you want, a minimum of, the HHSRS, for example, says to achieve 21 degrees inside at a reasonable period when it's 5 degrees outside. So you could take a little bit of each of the statutory guidance and say, we want 21 degrees inside within 2 hours when it's 5 degrees outside. There'll be plenty of people that can get a calculator out and work out the size of the radiators, the boiler, and whether we've achieved it or not. But I think say so rather than some loose.
So basically, as the bill stands, do you think there are enough protections and safeguards in place to ensure that standard of the properties for our, you know, for those renting is satisfactory?
The HHS.
Or do you think there's merit in increasing the landlord's repairing obligations? You're probably going to say no because of the nature. But I mean, Scotland have changed it. Why do you think they've changed it? Do you think there's any merit in Wales following the lead? I don't believe we should follow the lead in Scotland just because they've done it, but I'm curious, and you'll know more about this than me, as to why they've decided to go down that road.
Do you think we should do this in Wales?
I'm asking you.
Yeah, no.
What pitfalls are there to what they've done in Scotland, and what advantages do you think they've done?
I think it's all about perception as much as anything, isn't it? It's a fear of renting. You don't want to put the fear into landlords as to whether or not the property. What does it mean? Mm. I think it's the uncertainty. I think that's what we need. If you want a cooker, then tell us you want a cooker in every property in Wales. I think that's more the point. It's this unknown that is the worrying part, and not understanding whether or not. And then all you're doing is these single landlords, some call it accidental, I'm not sure that's the accurate term, but you don't want to be making these people criminals for not just simply not understanding something that was so complicated, a bit like the deposit legislation, so complicated in the first place that, you know, it wasn't really reasonable to criminalise them, really. So I think that's the point, is that it's this broad nature of its current method. It doesn't really say what you want. So I think it should say exactly what you want. And I think if those are within reasonable realms, so heating, like we've said, hot water, I don't think there's any need to have appliances. Personally, I don't provide any appliances in any of our properties at all, and tenants seem to actually quite like that, you know, because they have their own nowadays. Mum and dad give the old one, and you know, yeah, it's the freedom.
Your case example of increased regulation on white goods, most landlords, like Adrian, myself, I'm not sure about Doug, Don't provide them. It's easier. It's black and white, you know. Well, if I don't provide them,
you're not responsible.
I've got no comeback.
Yeah. Douglas, you had a response.
Yeah, on that point, we've got more and more landlords turning around and saying, well, we just won't supply them.
But I have to say, we've been working quite a lot on this over the last couple of weeks. It was quite a late addition into the bill on the stakeholder panel that I was sat on, so I didn't consider it as much as I would like to have done, and I have done a lot more now. Whilst I was like this about in the introduction of it before, the consequences of it are pretty dire, I think, and actually what we need to look at is making the HHSRS more usable, the for the for landlords and tenants to be able to understand. I suppose the area that we would like to see is we had something called La Cause or La Cause, however you like to pronounce it, which advised on the fire risk category and produced an excellent document. It was a really good document for guidance on. It wasn't prescriptive. It still allowed you to cater for the unique nature of tenants and the unique nature of the properties. But it laid down what the general interpretation was, but it also said, well, if you can't manage this, then do this, it reduces that risk. So it's a semi-prescriptive risk-based combination. So what I would like to see is really to look at the hazards within HHSRS and produce these sorts of guidance and documents and do that with a panel. Maybe it's some of us, some people that probably know more than me on these particular things as well, to be able to produce guidance that you can refer to, environmental health officers can refer to on a quicker guidance. If they need to do the fuller risk assessment, they still can. Tenants can refer to it, landlords can refer to it, and you guys can refer to it when you've got casework and says, well, actually, your landlord should be providing you with this. And this is, and if you can't do this, then he can do this. And that's where I'd like to see, because then that allows us to be a lot more effective with our enforcement. And I think Fitness for Human Habitation is just going to complicate it with two entirely independent systems.
And then my final question is, in its present form, is this bill going to be very onerous for the, you know, private landlord?
It depends what it looks like at the end.
But we did, I mean, obviously we did have quite a long discussion about that at the very
No, I know, but I want to know.
So I think, it, you know, obviously...
It's a fair question,
Yeah, Jeff. Well, we did discuss it earlier on as
Is it going to be, because the concerns I do have is that we've heard along the way rogue landlords, but am I right that half of the housing stock that's available for the rental market is owned? Do you know the exact figure? Owned by private landlords?
In Wales, it's now up to 15% in 16%.
Of the total rental market?
No. So, total housing market in Wales is up to 16%.
Right.
Around 78% of all landlords are one property landlords.
And Cardiff Council said 23% in Cardiff is PRS. I don't know if that's right or wrong, but that's a quote recently.
Of the stock
in Cardiff.
And there is a need, obviously, for private landlords. I know Absolutely. In my own constituency, there does seem to be this sort of theory that if you go to a private landlord, you're going to be worse off than if you go to a registered social landlord. And, you know, I think it's dispelling that myth, because I think people are lingering at the moment on lists when, really, they should have a little bit more confidence in private landlords. But whether the bill as it stands is going to be very onerous and may dissuade people from actually entering the private landlord market.
The model tenancy in particular is a worry. It's back to this prescribed information point that I keep bringing up, but it's daily, daily problem. It's that you're criminalising people for maybe forgetting a leaflet in a 40-page document.
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to overwhelm the tenant with all this paperwork that it is. And I mean, I don't think I'm exaggerating with 40 pages. And I think that's squashed up. overwhelm. And then that tied on with the deposit protection, it's just overwhelming. So I think in that element, I think there is a genuine fear in my mind of all these terms. And you're repeating, half the stuff is repeated. So you've got your tenancy, which sets out your key terms and all this. And then you go on to a leaflet that says exactly the same things over and over again. Well, why not either split it or, I don't know, but there must be a better way and just reduce. I mean, look at these mobile phone contracts. There's such tiny print now, and that's where I think this is aiming, consumer-led, almost like a standard mobile phone contract, perhaps similar words. I've never read mine.
Can I just say, we're going to have to, Douglas, I'll take a response. We're going to have to close this. We've got another panel coming, so we will have further questions for you. So, Douglas, do you want to respond?
I just want to support that, because Adrian's point is around criminalising landlords that aren't doing anything necessarily particularly wrong with the model contract. So I would like to see a default contract created which is classed as default if it's not issued. So if you don't issue it, you don't criminalise the landlord as with a penalty, but you just don't, and it encourages the landlord to still serve a contract, because quite frankly, you're nuts if you don't give a tenant a contract, and all of us along this panel would agree with that. But sometimes that happens for some reason, for whatever reason. So we want to say, well, yes, serve your contract, because then that's the exact terms that you're providing. But if you haven't provided those terms, then you're left with the default Welsh Government contract. And then that doesn't criminalise landlords, but it allows everybody to know and be able to get hold of a copy of what their contract should be if they don't have one.
The ones without a contract are all the really friendly landlords who only have one, who thought they were doing a favour by giving them the key. Yeah. That's all, in most cases, they are. They're not out to not give them a tenancy. They're just being nice, okay, in my view.
Well, on that point, can I thank you all for coming in this morning? I think it's been a very good session. We've had very detailed answers. So that we will send you some further questions that were remaining, and if you could do a written response, we'd be very grateful. So thank you very much.
No problem.
And
thank
we
you.
Break now until 10:50.
I am a tenant of a property in Cardiff. I need to register that.
Thank you, Roger. Okay.